It's my pleasure now to welcome the president of the University of Houston downtown. And I've known this gentleman for many years. As a matter of fact, the first time we met was sitting next to each other in the doctor's waiting room, waiting to get our flu shots. And he was brand new at that university, and we started visiting, and I thought his area was political science. He's a social worker. And so as soon as I got my shot, I ran back to my office and looked his vita up, and sure enough, he is a political scientist, but he's also run mental health centers, and he knows the work that we do very well. And he's been extremely supportive on the Center for Family Strengths at the University of Houston downtown. So I know he's got a very busy schedule. We're very, very pleased he could take a minute to be with us this morning. So let me introduce to you one of the 100 most influential Hispanics in the United States. And my guess is he's probably even more influential because he goes to a lot of meetings at the White House. But Dr. William Flores.
Well, I want to welcome all of you to the University of Houston downtown. Some of you have been here already a couple of days, or started yesterday. Some wonderful workshops, some great people. But, you know, I also want to thank Elvin. Elvin, as he said, we've known each other for a while. We served together on the New Mexico Center for Behavioral Health Training and Research Board. And that was responsible for all behavioral health for the state of New Mexico. And I served on the Behavioral Health Collaborative, which oversaw all of the contracts for behavioral health for the state of New Mexico. I got my experience in healthcare and in social work years ago, running a prevention program and then a Spanish-speaking mental health center, and we expanded to provide services to the Vietnamese, Lao, and other communities as refugees came in, including Ethiopians, Eritreans, and really served the entire community, but we particularly were strong with refugee and resettlement issues. I saw in my work trauma of people that were abused, issues that came up in sexual abuse, child abuse, trauma related to immigration, torture, many other kinds of things that disrupt the health of a family. Children that couldn't function in schools because of the constant fear that someone would abuse them. Children who and adolescents who couldn't even talk whether it was a priest or a minister, because of that fear. Because they would be just put back to their family. And yet at the same time, I saw the dangers of family separation and the importance of family reunification and efforts to do that. So when I met Elvin, it was, I was provost at New Mexico State University and proud that we had a stellar social work department. He was chair of the department at that time, and of course had the Family Preservation Institute, which we now have here as a Family Center for Family Strengths. I am really proud that we have that continuity long-term from with the journal that is done, with the connections that have been made through the work that Elvin and other people have done here in Texas and nationally. That brings a great deal of connections and prestige to the University of Houston downtown. So I'm proud as a president, but also as someone who has been a practitioner, to know that we will be providing opportunities and service to this community. That we'll be training, and we are training, of course, social workers. Our program is now accredited. And we learned that news this fall. So we went through the accreditation process. That's a great thing. And of course, Alvin and others in the faculty worked hard to get that. I also want to thank Scott Dixon and Lori Lewis-Carley and many others who have served on the advisory board for the Center for Family Strength. Joel Levine, Joel was here a minute ago. Is he still here? At any rate, there's so many people that are giving us the opportunity to work closely with agencies to build the connections that strengthen not only the university, but the opportunity for our students to engage, to provide service, to get supervision hours, and to learn. And these conferences, they provide an opportunity for practitioners to learn from each other, for you to be exposed to other psychologists, mental health professionals, doctors, social workers, people from throughout the various kinds of fields that have for many times worked with families, worked with immigrant populations, worked with children, and to hear evidence-based practice, to find out what works, what doesn't work, what are we trying to implement, and how can we improve the services that we provide to some of the most, not only needy, but in need, and of our community. Whether they be children, whether they be women, whether they be families that have been disrupted in one way or another. And I want to thank each of you, not just for being here, but for the work you do as providers. You know, many times the agencies, whether they're state agencies, whether they're county agencies, whether they're you're a city employee, whether you work for a nonprofit, you don't get the kind of thanks that you deserve, or recognition that you deserve. Oftentimes, if anything, you get a phone call for somebody complaining because this didn't happen, or this occurred, or something that you absolutely had to do because you're mandated by law to do it. But we thank you, because without the work that you do every day, that we could never have strong families. And I'm proud to have the Center for Family Strengths here at UHD. We hope that you will help us build it to make it stronger. Network with us. Build this conference as we do it each year. Learn from it. Write articles for the journal that can share not only within Texas and within Houston, but it is nationally distributed so that people can learn about the work you're doing, and you can learn about work that is based on evidence and supported. I thank you. I hope you have a wonderful conference, and I look forward to learning from your experience.
Thank you very much, President Flores, and we really appreciate having a university president who knows what social work is and then supports it and the Center for Family Strength so well. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure now to introduce another gentleman that I've had the opportunity of knowing for many years. I guess that means all my friends are getting old like me. But I believe we first started working together in 1994 when Texas received funding for family preservation, and myself and a couple other people were invited to help develop the statewide plan that's now developed into family-based services. And I know just last year we had the opportunity to work very closely together, and I'm still flabbergasted. I must have been dreaming, but we got the state agency, the county Child Protective Services, the university, and a private non-for-profit, actually for-profit agency, to work together. In about a month, we put together a program for a summer camp for kinship families. And we're going to hear the panel, one of the workshops at 1:30 is going to be addressing this as well, Dr. Friedman. But I knew that this gentleman knew a lot about social work and had great insight, but I was able to see how he had tremendous administrative skills as well to help this come about so quickly. So I haven't woken up yet, so maybe I'm still dreaming, but I'm so pleased to have bringing a message from the Assistant Commissioner, Audrey Deckinga. We're very pleased to have Scott Dixon here joining us. He works very closely with our social work program on their advisory board as well, and we're so pleased that you're able to come and tell us what the Department of Family Protective Services is doing at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Alvin. And University of Houston downtown, go. I went here back, I always joke about when I came to school here, it's like 1980, 81, 82. And I had a professor, he called it Harvard on the Bayou. And I think it was the Gators is what we call it, University of Houston downtown Gators. But it's great to come back. This is a great university system. All those students that we have in the room, CPS always has jobs for y'all once y'all graduate. So just go online and fill out your application and we'll be happy to accommodate you. We do have a very strong relationship with University of Houston. We have a master's program at the main campus, and here, like it's been discussed, the accreditation did happen for the BSW program. We're optimistic that down the road that we'll have what we call a 4E program, which allows students to go to school for social work in those last 2 years, and then guaranteed work with the department and your school will be covered. So hopefully in the years to come, not so long years to come, we'll have this put together. The symposium with the family preservation, I have to be cautious when I use family preservation, because over the years, like Alvin said, back in the early 90s, when there's a lot of money and a lot of tension put into family preservation, yes, let's keep the family strong, let's keep children in their homes, let's keep them safe, all those good things that we strive to do, because, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute, but somewhere down the road, family preservation became a negative, and we had to kind of change our focus to family-centered focus, kinship care, trying to strengthen the family, but ensure safety. All those issues came about because once in a while we think we're doing good work or something slips through the cracks and something bad happens. And when something bad happens, like we talk about, the negative side, the complaint side, it really sets us back. The media will attack us and say, y'all have had history with this family for 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years. You know, you stabilize them, you put a Band-Aid on them, you close your case, you come back, years later, there are same issues. You don't look at the safety behind the family issues with the children. And that is not true. We always try to do the best that we can, although there is still a big belief out there through a lot of our social networks and even through the court system that the apple does not fall far from the tree. And so there's a lot of education that we've done over the years. These type of conferences really dig into it, and you'll love this next conference when we start talking to the parents that have experienced our program. You know, Kenneth, as some of y'all met Kenneth, he is the Fatherhood Initiative, and this is a whole new thing. You know, before, a few years ago, we didn't even talk about fathers. It was always the mother's family. Rarely, you know, where's dad? Oh, I don't know where dad is. He didn't have a dad. Well, everybody's got a dad, right, Kenneth? So it was just a matter of trying to search out these fathers, which we're trying to do, really looking at their side of the family as possible placements for children and kind of go from there. You know, I was talking to an attorney last week. I'm in a kind of a situation now with a particular court, and I'm having to deal with it with some other staff, but there's issues that come about children that are in at-risk situations, whether with their family, extended family, those type of situations. And, you know, a lot of people think the answer is, well, remove them from the family, put them into foster care system. And we know that that is only a last resort situation because of what happens to children when they're separated from their family. It's very traumatic for them. The scars are there. You've got to ensure children are safe, but there's got to be options for children and the families. In 2009, we developed a program, and you'll hear a little bit about it today, I'm sure, if you haven't heard already, is an enhanced family-centered safety decision-making process. And it took a lot of effort to get this initiative going because there's still a lot of confusion about what is risk and what is safety. Is it a safety-related issue or is it a risk-related issue? Well, I don't know about you, but you know, I think every family has a little bit of risk in it. Everybody has an uncle out there or an aunt or someone that may have some mental health issues, some medical issues, criminal-related issues. There's a lot of factors that come into play. And dealing with family dynamics, you'll rarely run into someone that has the perfect family. And I hear it once in a while, I had the perfect childhood, I have the perfect parents, I had the perfect grandparents. And I just say, well, God bless you, you know, because I know I don't have that. So, you know, families have many, many strengths. It's a lot of times it's very hard to find those strengths. And a lot of times we have to do a lot of training, a lot of really looking at the family as a whole and dialoguing with the parents, the caretakers, and the children in order to achieve those strengths. But in this enhanced family-centered safety decision-making model, you know, we've really tried to look at cases, and Lori's done a great job trying to go to the regions and have us really analyze these cases. Is this child in a safe environment? Is it what risks have been identified? Are the caretakers protective? All those factors are extremely important in the values that we put on families. We look at basic values in our family preservation program. And, you know, all children should be free of harm. That's a given. So whenever you hear concepts about family preservation, all efforts to keep the family together, safety is always going to be the number one factor, and always keep that in mind. I do have to look at situations, and I've become pretty vocal with our own staff. When you have a family that has had multiple investigations, family-based services where we've tried to keep the family intact, but things just seem to go like this, up and down, there needs to be an intervention when that next case comes in. I don't know what that intervention may be. There may be a very protective family member out there that is willing to take these children in, but history shows us that there are some real issues with this family. And some families, face it, some families will not get the help they need if it's mental health issues or substance abuse issues. With Child Protective Services, 80% of our families basically fit in those two ranges, and most of them have both. So it's very difficult work, especially when you have caseworkers that are way overloaded with caseloads, but safety has to be the most important factor. The other belief that we believe so strongly is that children are best raised by their families. We see this over and over again, and if any of you went to the youth panels or talked to any of our youth that grew up in the foster care system, the number one thing they'll talk about is, I miss my brothers and sisters. And this is so saddening, but this is a reality of the foster care system. A lot of our families have more than one child, two children, three children. It could be four, five, six, and even up to the teens. Whenever we have to go into a legal situation and remove the children from their environment, most likely these children will be placed in other foster care facilities. They'll be separated. So we've pushed a lot of work, or we've done a lot of work over the years to try and keep those connections together, federal government, the state, a lot of programs to keep them together, but it's still not good enough. And you'll hear our youth talk about how they really miss their brothers and sisters. And those of us that come from large families like myself, you don't realize that till you don't have it. When you have brothers and sisters, you know, you hate them, you want your own room, you know, this one's spoiled, this is the favorite. But the realities are the realities. When you're away from your family, you miss them. And this is something that we really are trying to do a lot of work in, is to keep these sibling connections together. The second piece that we've also noticed over and over again is when children that grow up in the foster care system, the minute they get out, what do they want to do? They want to go back home to their parents. There's a lot of factors that come into play with this. You know, back when I was going to graduate school at Texas State, back then Southwest, we did a lot of work on interviewing the children, the youth that are aging out, and talking about the issues that they're experiencing currently. A lot of them have this belief that that they can go back and help their parents, that they can heal their parents. A lot of our youth have been in multiple years of therapy, and they have the jargon, they know the routine, and there's just a natural response that I want to go back and help put my family together to keep them whole. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But over the last few years, we've had to take a real look at this, and we do it with our circles of support, and really trying to get these connections reestablished at about age 16, 17, going into their adult years, because we know these youth are going to reconnect with their families. And we want them to understand the dynamics that are still going on with their families, if there are some, around substance abuse related issues, or like I said, mental health related issues. But we want to start bridging that gap, and we've been very successful in doing it, but we can always do better. And this is an area that has really grown over the last 10 years, as well as family preservation, is our youth and our youth aging out. We realize that we're not good parents. You know, raising a child in the foster care system, we do the best we can. The foster parents are wonderful people, but the reality of it is we're a substitute parent. And whenever children can be with family, they need to be with family. So those connections we're really trying to establish with the work that we're doing. And it takes people like you to do this work. Families are tough. I get a kick out of people that come into work for us. They'll say, I want to work with children. You know, your child protective services. I love children. I want to work with children. Reality is, man, your work is probably 10% kids. It's 90% parents. And computer, and those of you who work for CPS, all the bureaucracy that comes with it. But the reality of it is you have to look at the child and the family as one. It's a centered focus practice. And you know, what exhibits out there in behavior sometimes is purely related to the dynamics of the family. And sometimes we can go in and really do an aha and put that family together and work with a great support system and be out, and we're out forever. Sometimes it just doesn't work that way. So keep in mind, and I always stress this, it is safety first, but it is so important that you keep those connections and establish the family. I want to thank you for having the opportunity. Audrey Decker couldn't be here. She's my boss in Austin and a couple of others, the assistant commissioner. But we all understand the importance of these type of symposiums and conferences, and really salute the leadership to putting it together, and all of you for attending. And like I said, CPS always has jobs, so please come see us when you're ready to come to work for us. Thank you.
And that was Mr. Dixon, who's the regional administrator of Region 6, which includes the greater Houston area. So that's his official title. The next person I'm going to introduce that will be introducing our panel today is someone that's worked on the board with the Center for Family Strength since our inception, and has been an incredible supporter, not only from giving suggestions on workshops, but also I've seen her at the administrative level really move things and make things happen. So I know when sometimes we're facing tough administrative and cutbacks and so forth, I can always call on this woman, and she'll not only boost my spirit, but she'll also get it done. And we're very pleased to have her to introduce this. She's also an instructor with the University of Texas Graduate School of Social Work, teaching child abuse, and so she's able to bring the world of practice and her great expertise into the classroom as well, and I think they are very fortunate to have her. We also are glad to see the way that she's been able to support family-based services as the program manager in Austin, and has been able to kind of, as Scott was saying, shift the focus a little bit and build a very strong program. One of our exhibitors here, as you may have noticed, is with the Department of Health and Human Services out of Washington, D.C., and I was looking over one of their publications today, and Texas and the programs that Lori Lewis Connerly has worked on is featured in that as well. So we'd like to introduce to you Lori Lewis Connerly, who will introduce the panel members. Thank you.
Good morning. Okay, where are my child welfare folks in the house? Raise your hands. All right, give it up for child welfare in the house. And we appreciate the presence of everyone who is here on behalf of working with children and families. Good morning again. My name is Lori Lewis Connerly, and I am a social worker. And I am very proud of being a social worker. I was just telling my class last night that if I had to go back and do it all over again, I would do it the same. I don't regret one moment of my education. I don't regret one moment of the work that I've done for the past years. I would go back and do it the same because, see, what I had to come to understand is that I was doing social work when I didn't even realize I was doing social work. But even better than that, my parents were doing social work when they didn't even know there was a name to what they were doing. So it's in my blood. It's who I am. I'm here to help. I'm a faith believer, and we believe that we're saved to serve. And so I do this, and I do it gladly. And so I'm happy about being with this work and working with children and families because, you know, Scott said, you know, I want to work with CPS because I like children. You better like some parents too. You know what I'm saying? You better like some parents too because we're about the family, okay? And I cannot think of a better task that I have here this morning than to introduce someone who is so about the family. And I'm going to stretch out on a limb and I'm going to put in a couple of remarks for him too. But I want to make sure that you guys know that the Department of Family and Protective Services, Child Protective Services, we're invested in families, we're invested in parents, we're invested in children, and we do that and we show that in everything that we do. In the last maybe 6-7 years, We really put our money where our mouth was. And we hired, and I think the first in the nation, the first parent support specialist in the United States. Yeah, give it up. This is actually someone who has walked the system, has experienced CPS, and now she's employed with CPS, and she's leading the other parents and children and families and staff in helping bridge the gap between partnering. I was in a workshop earlier this morning and I heard one of the persons in the audience say, you know, when I work with my families, I try and emphasize to them that I'm here to partner with you. I was like, wow, I wish I had a prize in my purse. You know, and Deshaun exemplifies that. She is such a believer in parents, and she really makes sure that the parents' voice is heard throughout the agency, through policy, through work groups, through community. I mean, she's absolutely awesome. And here recently, within the last 2 years, we hired a sidekick for her. Kenneth Thompson, Big Daddy, okay? And Kenneth is out there, like Scott said, really helping us bring home the role of the father and acknowledging the father and the importance of having a relationship with your father. I can't speak for everybody else, but hey, my daddy rocks. Okay, I'm going to be working in Tennessee next week for work, and I called my daddy to come down and join me, and he said, okay. So I told Deshaun that I can't wait to go to dinner because my daddy gonna pay for my food. Okay? So I'm not going to take any more of your time, but I too thank you for being here. I thank you for being invested in what you do. And again, you will not regret sitting in this seat for the next hour and a half, because you're about to hear some training and some information and some teaching and some learning at its best. It is with great pride and privilege that I present to you Deshaun Elams.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be back again. I've been coming here for the past 5 years now, and I want to thank Dr. Flores and Mr. Solis for allowing the parents to be the keynote address and share their voices and to help the caseworkers. But with the sake of time, I just want to let you know Kenneth Thompson is going to moderate the panel. We've got some questions for them, and we should get started now. Thank you, and I hope you all enjoy, and we will have time for questions. So get your questions ready for the parents, and thank you. Good luck, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. All right, good morning, good morning. Come on, y'all, good morning. You know, my name is Kenneth Thompson. I am the Fatherhood Program Specialist of the agency, and I think I've been around now for about 3 or 4 years. And one of the things that I value before I get in this conversation is that everywhere we go today, and matter of fact, I just left a presentation, and I'm always critiquing it now to make sure that there's something in these presentations that deals with fathers, because not a single one of us here got here without one. So we do add value. And so this morning to the panel, the PCG, the Parent Collaboration Group, to me, it's one of the most powerful tools that we have in our arsenal. Anytime you can hear the voices from those folks who have lived it, no matter how we want to do it, if you ain't been through it, you ain't been through it. And so here's parents who have been through the system, who is healthy, and now they come back and provide a service. So I think that says a lot about you also. And the other thing that I'm delighted about is that when we do these panels, there's always a father present, you know? And so what I want you to do, we'll start here first. I want you to pick that mic up, right? And I want you to talk, start with the first. Yes, absolutely. Yes, 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 you. Uh-huh, you know. And just tell us your name, just a little bit about yourself, and then we'll get into the questions.
Is it on?
Yes, on.
My name is Melissa Vizcaino, and I'm the state parent rep for El Paso Region 10. A little bit about myself. I'm a mother of two, single mother. I'm going to school, I'm working, and I was once in the system for 2 years, and I didn't have my kids for 7 months, so it's pretty difficult, but got through it.
Hey, everybody, I'm Alicia. I was in foster care my whole life. It's about from seven, I think is when I was first in foster care. But then I have a 10-year-old child. I had 3 CPS cases against him. I am a recovering drug addict. I didn't have my son for a few months, and that was the worst pain that I ever felt in my life. And so I've been doing what I've been doing to learn how to live differently and be a good mama to him. So that's about me.
I'm Ashley Quinn. I'm also parent advocate for CPS over Region 5, and I have 3 children. I've lost my kids twice, once to foster care for 6 months, and then I lost them again due to drugs and alcohol. And now I have my kids, and I'm of service today, and I'm trying to help other parents know that they don't have to lose their kids.
My name is Terry Osborne. I'm from Abilene, Region 2, originally from Wichita Falls area. I'm a parent liaison for the Empower Group. We use that group to work with other parents that are going through the same process that I did. And I'm currently a senior at Abilene Christian University as a psychology major. I graduate in December, and I start my graduate work in social work in January, and I've also completed substance abuse counseling coursework. So I just love what I do using my experience and being able to assist parents through this process like I had to go through. Thank you all for letting me be here.
Awesome.
Okay, so let's start with the first question. What can a social worker do to help a family work better with their supportive and unsupportive family members? And any one of you can take that question.
Hello. I'm going to use I statements because that's how I learned to be honest, is use I statements. I think my supportive family members harms me more than helps me because there's this little thing called enabling. And I think supportive parents, in order to help them, you know, supportive family members, they need to know you cannot enable that person. The worst thing you can do for somebody like myself is give me no consequences. If you take away my consequences, I won't feel that pain and I won't do anything different. And as far as unsupportive family members, it's okay. I mean, I have plenty of unsupportive family members that are tired of me. They're tired of my way of life. They were just done with me, and it was okay with that. And I had to let them know it's okay that you don't want to support me. It's okay that I've said I'm sorry way too many times. So I think that the only thing that will change that is for me to change, for them to see the change inside of me, because I can't force somebody to support me. And even if I tried to, it would harm me better than help me. So that would be my suggestion.
So, Alicia, if you could, I mean, when we think about the social workers perhaps that was in your life also, and talking about those same two groups, you know, that supportive family member and that unsupported family member, what could social workers perhaps have done in terms of helping or dealing with that issue also, those relationship issues? Mm-hmm. And if you can't, we'll pass it on to someone else.
Okay, I'm going to use I statement too. My experience is that I had a lot of family member already in recovery. So with CPS knowing that I had a support system at home, it was better for me. Because if someone knows what I'm going through, I need that support. I need a family member to be, when I can't handle my kids, because I used the whole time my kids were growing up, and now I'm sober and I'm trying to raise these kids and I'm trying to get my things back together, I need to know that somebody's gonna have my back. And as far as the unsupportive, I think there's things that we could do to get them more involved, as far as, because some of them just don't understand. Like, why can't you get right? Well, I can't get right because I'm sick. Like, I have something wrong with me. It's not that I wanted to choose drugs over my kids. It's who I am. And until I learn to do something about it, then there's really nothing no one can do. So to get the families to get a better understanding of what's really going on.
So are you saying that one of the things that social workers can do in this process is get families together so therefore you can have a more complete support system?
Absolutely. I think that it's better for everybody, including the kids, you know, so that we can all come together. It's because it's a family thing. It's a family disease. I'm speaking about alcohol and drugs because that's my experience. But it affects everyone in the family.
Okay. Terry, you want to try that one?
The same question?
Yes, sir.
I think that through my experience, you know, my two daughters were placed with my parents. And I think that the social worker, it's a vital situation where they become an effective mediator. And I say that because I think that the stigmas and the attitudes towards substance abuse, in my case, obviously my parents were angry and frustrated. And they wanted to, you know, they had their attitudes, you know, against me and my wife, and didn't think about the children. So I think it's real important that the social worker be an effective mediator and incorporate that mediation and letting them know that it's important for effective communication among all parties.
Okay. Anybody else?
Really, what I was just going to say, that for the unsupportive family, like as far as the social worker, what they could do is probably educate them and let them know, you know, what we're going through, what the process is and everything, you know, to let them know that, you know, in this case, we do need some kind of support, even if they don't, you know, believe that, you know, because as an addict, like, oh, they could just stop. It's just their choice. And, you know, they just don't want to change, you know, that's their mentality. But if a caseworker could actually educate them on what the disease is of addiction and, you know, how our process is, you know, because it's way different from, you know, the norm, how we say, you know, it's, we think differently, you know, and in this kind of cases, we just kind of push the family away and, you know, want to yell at them and want to tell them, like, you know, this is what's going on. Like, why can't you be there? So I feel like as a caseworker, you know how Terry was saying, you know, they become the mediator. If they could just educate the unsupported part of the family, you know, and let them know what we're going through, I think that would kind of encourage them to be more involved.
And I like that. And can we just expand just a little bit again on the, what about the unsupportive family, those who are, that's not feeling you,
well,
you know?
That's what I was saying, okay. Like the unsupportive family maybe needs to be educated. As okay. far as the supportive family, I would say, you know, just encourage them. Also not to be, you know, enabling our behavior, but to let them know that, you know, as them being there and being supportive, they also need to be giving us that tough love, you know, and that's telling us that what we did was wrong, but, you know, we could change, you know, and as far as the unsupportive family, you know, just educate them, basically.
Thank you. The next question, what can social workers do better? What can social workers do better to empower and involve parents in CPS work?
I think that it's very, very important that we you know, parents have been taught generationally that it's the agency versus the parent. It's the agency against us. It's and that mindset and attitude's got to change. It's got to be, we've got to teach, we've got to work with parents that we're going to collectively, you know, we're going to identify the problem and we're together going to find a solution, and I'm going to help you. That I believe is the definition of social work. And I think that you know, parents have been taught over you know, many years that it's you against me. So automatically, when they hear the word CPS, it's automatically their guards up, ready to fight. And if we can do, as you know, social workers, cultivate that attitude and environment to let them become their own advocate, that empowers them, and that gives them hope. And that's what we're in the business of is supplying hope. You know, oftentimes I hear when I work with parents, I'm amazed at some of the attitudes that parents have to experience. And you know, we have it within our, I believe that we have it within our power to either build or destroy. And once we've destroyed that hope, then what's the worth, you know, why is it worth fighting for? And I think that's where the empowerment, allowing them to become their own advocate.
So can you talk a little bit about, Terry, if you could, if when you was involved, what did we do for you? Did we do anything to empower you in your experience, social workers?
Mine was a substance abuse related. For me, the obviously the biggest thing and the biggest assistance was me getting substance abuse treatment. Okay. You know, oftentimes when I didn't know anything about addiction and how to treat addiction, just as much as I think some caseworkers and some investigators don't know about addiction.
Okay.
And I think that, you know, through that process, you have a lot of people that really don't, you know, and none of us really understand completely how addiction works, completely. And I think it was just these statements of, well, if you love your children enough, you'll just stop. And those kinds of statements, and you know, you get to the point where you just accept the fact that I'm just going to be an addict for the rest of my life because that's what people tell me, and that's just the way the outcome has been. So getting treatment for my substance abuse was the biggest help for me.
Okay.
I just wanted to add a little bit on that. This kind of reminds me of the statement that I always say, if I'm not okay, my kids aren't okay. And I believe that as a social worker, you know, you get individual cases, and that's exactly what they are, individual cases. You know, you should look at the person as an individual. Yes, they've done bad. Yes, they've done things that are not, you know, acceptable, but that's not who they are. So it's like getting to know the individual. Every single person gets the same kind of case plan. You know, you have to do this, you have to do that because it's required. No, get to know your client, get to know the parent and see what exactly they need. Some of us come in with substance abuse. Some of us come in, you know, with, you know, mental issues. And that's exactly in my case. Mine was more for feelings and my emotions were driving me nuts, you know, and that's what drove me to doing the substance abuse. And that's what drove me to doing the neglect to my children. So I feel like if individually you get to know the parent, that's where it's going to help you better this parent to help the kid, because that's where you have to start with the parent, you know, so they could be, the kids could be okay. And I guess that's what kind of pushed me, because my caseworker, I could just remember her. She encouraged me so much individually. And at the time, I'm getting emotional, sorry. And at the time, I wasn't working. and I was kind of like at rock bottom, completely rock bottom. Excuse me.
That's okay. That's okay.
And it was Christmas time, so she gave me out of her own pocket $30 and told me, go get your babies this. Go get them something for Christmas. It was something small, but she believed in me. And that's where I think, as an individual, that meant so much to me. You know, and she saw me more than just the substance abuse. She saw me more as just being a bad parent, like I was being labeled, you know. And I believe that as a social worker, you shouldn't do no labeling. You know, it's about the individual. Their upbringing was different from yours, you know, from everybody's. Everybody's was different, you know, and in my case, you know, I held on to a lot of the stuff that, you know, I was, how I was raised. So I believe that's how I ended up where I was at, you know, and she took that time to figure that out and gave me the help I actually needed, you know, and I think that's what a caseworker should actually do.
Anyone else? Alicia and Ashley, you want to ask, you have anything you want to add to that?
Well, I actually think that Terry and Melissa did a way better job than explaining that than I could have. But I will tell you, guys, something that I know from my experience, I know that if we turned all the lights off in here right now, turned them all off, and it was pitch dark and you couldn't see anything, if a light bug came in here, everybody in here would look at that little light bug flying around in this really, really dark auditorium. And I think each person has a small little light bug inside of them. So the social worker can reach into that person and figure out how to make this light bug grow. A light bug of hope in me wasn't enough for me to change my life. If I knew what hope was, I wouldn't have been living like that. CPS wouldn't have had to come in the first place. So I needed to learn about hope. I needed to learn that I was worth something. And my social worker did that for me. She believed in me too, and I entered a 12-step program, which taught me a lot about my life. But my caseworker, we're really good friends today, she was in a 12-step program, so that she learned that everything she had to see throughout the day, I mean, social workers have to see really horrible stuff. You guys, most of y'all know that. And so that changes a social worker, a person inside of them, after all the things they've seen and all the things they've had to hold on to. So just like what Melissa was saying, I have to, you got a social worker would have to leave that situation where it is and not take it on to the next case and the next case and the next case. And I think if more social workers did that, maybe a 12-step program, some kind of support group for things that a social worker has to see and have to go through, maybe the turnover for social workers wouldn't be so insane. But that's what I would have to say about that.
I mean, they did a great job. I think as far as social workers and they're doing it now as far as referrals with us PCG, when they see a parent hopeless and needs some extra support and they refer them to one of our meetings or things like that. Also, when I do work with other parents, you know, you hear a lot of them say that the caseworkers do, like, immediately, you're a bad person, you know, instead of looking at them as an individual because they see so many times, or like me, a repeat offender, what makes you so different? You know, what makes this time so different? And in that very moment when they told me that, I broke down because this time I didn't know that I was a sick mom. Like, I just thought I was this horrible person, you know? Nobody never told me that there was a solution. Nobody never told me that I never had a drink or use again, you know? And I was hopeless. And I thought, and they told me also that if I ever drank or used again, that I would never see my kids. And that was sufficient for me. Still in that hopeless state of mind, my caseworker, because I was in a treatment facility that was supervised, allowed my daughter to come in with me. And I had something tangible then. So that empowered me to want to keep moving forward because I have my daughter with me and I'm going to do what I need to do so I can have all my kids back together. So I think as far as being empowered, you're kind of on the right track with the parent collaboration group.
Good, good. How can social workers help families identify their strengths and use them to support their work in the case?
Well, I feel like that it's just that right there. I think oftentimes what happens is when CPS intervenes, it's automatically we're pointing out the faults and the weaknesses of the family or the individual within the family. And I think that when we take the time to, if we want to identify a person's strengths, then we're going to obviously have to take the time to invest in them personally. And in order to identify those strengths, it takes the willingness to spend time with them and pull those strengths out, because we all have strengths. And I think that during this time of, you know, probably the most painful and most painful struggle you'll ever experience, boy, that really could be empowering and motivating, you know, for someone to invest in you and be willing to pull those strengths out and use those strengths to help you in your weakness.
The question's still open there. You know, so anybody want to interject on that also? Go ahead.
Well, like basically how he was saying, you know, taking the time to know the individual and just asking them, like prior to my case, I had education, you know, like I had gone to school for nursing, but I stopped because of my use. So I believe that, you know, if the caseworker could look at what their passion is or what they're trying to do in life, where they want to be, push them to do that. You know, like it could be something as simple as, you know, wanting to be a writer or something, you know, like just encourage them to journal every single day, you know, so they could get that feeling out and, you know, process stuff, I guess you could say, you know, and kind of get to where they want to be in life. And it's just individual, like treat everybody as an individual and you'll see their strengths, you know, and just encourage that more. And if, you know, how I said, you know, we made bad choices, we were bad parents, you know what I mean? We're not bad parents, we just didn't know how, you know, so just kind of encourage them to do what they know is best, you know, and just try to avoid the negativity.
Good point.
I also know as people, we start learning to be negative at a young age, whether you're no matter what you are, you learn to be negative at a young age because you have parents saying, don't touch that, it's hot, no, you can't go here. You know, parents train children, so it's no, 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 and children are learning negativity, you know, at a young age. So we already know, I'm gonna tell you for me, I know how to be negative. I've been negative my whole entire life. I don't know how to be positive. I'm a weak person. If I was strong, then I wouldn't be living like this. So I think that what you guys said is definitely great, but I wouldn't have knew how to answer that. I just know how important it is to help them find their strengths.
So are y'all saying, I just want to make sure I can paraphrase this, are you saying that what we should do as social workers, spend a little time to get to know the family?
Yes.
You think that's important?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to make sure because I think as we talked about when we introduced this conversation, you know, we talked about family-centered, you know, so therefore, one of the things we're trying to focus on is making sure we get a chance to know the family. Go ahead, Alicia.
Well, I just wanted to say it might be a case in a computer. It might be a name on a file, but we are people. We have blood in us. We have children. We learned how to live like we were living. If we knew different, like I said, we would have been doing different. We didn't know different. We are people. I have a child. I have a mother. I'm a person. So definitely I needed somebody to stop and care enough about me to say, hey, you don't have to do this anymore. Let me show you different.
Oh, dear. You're going to have me using these Kleenex up here after a while. Okay. How can social workers best support you in the face of your challenges when you're involved with CPS?
I think it's, like, as far as when CPS gets involved, our kids get taken away. That's the first thing. Or it might be different in some cases where the kid actually gets to be there. But in my experience, I actually left my kids. You know, I left them with my grandparents, which they later on called CPS on me, you know, because I abandoned them in their eyes, you know. I didn't want to go back. So I feel, and as a caseworker, they could support me a little bit more and talk to the parents to where I could see them, you know, because since I had left them, they didn't want me to be around, you know. So a caseworker, I feel, could kind of just be like, hey, this is what you did, and this is where they're at right now also. So let's try and work together. You know, let's try to work something out to where you could see your kids. And instead of just being like, you know what, we schedule this, and if they don't want to work with you, that's it. Because that's what I would always hear. Like, once my first caseworker left, I got a second one, and that was when my whole case changed on me. And I wasn't seeing my kids. I wasn't just getting no visitation rights, you know? So I kept calling her and telling her, hey, this is what's going on. And that was my biggest challenge, is not seeing my kids. Through this whole process, it was just not seeing my kids. And it's heartbreaking, you know, because you're used to being with your kids 24/7. Well, in my case, I was with my kids 24/7, using or not. Like, I had my kids, you know, at the park, wherever it was. So me not having them just kind of made me lose hope, you know, completely. It's just like that person that you could hug every single morning just to give you that little bit of hope or just to give you that little bit of love wasn't there no more, you know? So as a caseworker, I feel, you know, you could encourage the parents to let the kids be around a little bit more around the parents, you know? And as far as other challenges, I was taken to court, you know what I mean? And I was going to be getting my kids taken away from me. Actually, experienced a relapse in my whole casework. So because of the relapse, I actually, you know, went to court and everything, but my caseworker was there, you know, and she told me, I'm sorry I have to do this, but this is my job. And her just coming to me and telling me, this is what I have to do, don't hold it against me, and I still believe in you, but this is what I have to do. You know, it just kind of made me feel a little bit better. And I had so much anger towards her, and just like Alicia was saying earlier, I'm so close to her now, you know what I mean? And it just kind of built a relationship. And I don't know if it's because of the parent collaboration group, but after my case closed, she kind of was just like, hey, like, come help out, you know what I mean? Come speak to the parents, come let the parents know what's going on, how the process is. And I think that's another thing, if the caseworkers could actually explain the process and actually let us know what's gonna happen if you do this or if you do that, not just say, if you don't do this, you have to do this, so you're gonna lose your kids. No, look, this is what's gonna happen. We're going to be investigating you, and then after the investigation, we're going to see what you need as an individual, you know. And I think that would kind of encourage the parent to kind of, you know, open up a little bit more, because how Terry had said earlier too, we have our guards up big time. We become mama bear, papa bear, and just like, you're not taking our baby away, you know, this is our babies. But of course, CPS didn't come looking for us, we went looking for them, you know? So this is where we kind of, as an individual, have to open up our minds and, you know, work with them, you know? And just as a caseworker, try to get your client see that, you know what? You need to see that what you're doing isn't right, and I'm trying to help you. If I could hear, I'm trying to help you, it would make a big difference, because it was just like, you have to do this and that's it, you know? It's more like, I'm trying to help, and it's in wording and everything, you know? Just, I guess also like showing some kind of concern and not just being so tough yourself.
So are you saying at all that the way we talk to you matters also?
I definitely believe that. It's in how you say everything. I love to read into words. And as, you know, a parent, you know, of course, how I said, we have our guard up. So we're not really listening to you unless you have like this, if you have like a very defensive demeanor towards us, we're not gonna listen. You know, so if you could kind of let your guard down also, because we're not, like how I said, we're individuals, we're all different, you know? And I believe as a caseworker, you become kind of hard also, and you get this like kind of image of every parent is not gonna work with you, you know? And some might not want to work with you, you know, but others might. In my case, I'm not saying I wanted CPS, but I needed help. And I looked for it, and I looked for it in the wrong ways, of course, by leaving my kids, but I'm here now. It didn't really matter how it happened. I'm here now, you know? Good. That's just how I see it.
Anyone else want to add to that? Anybody else want to ask that? Ashley, I see you grabbing the mic. Go ahead.
I'm just going to add a little.
Go ahead.
Like when I do group, and I think it's very important for CPS, like she said, when I do group, I tell them from the door, CPS does not want your kids. Like, that is not what they're here to do. Because a lot of people are defensive. Like she said, mama and papa bear, like, you're not coming. I mean, I myself was like, I'm going to take my kids. I'm going to Mexico. And we're going to find us. You know what I mean? Because I don't want my babies to be gone. Those are my life. They're my life. Today, CPS saved my life. And I know that to be true, and that's why I do this. So when I do group, I let them know, like, CPS, they don't want your kids. They want your kids with you, you know? So if some caseworkers would come in and say, I don't want to take your kids. This is not, like, I don't get joy out of taking, because a lot of parents, like he said, we think that CPS is against us. You know, they want our kids, they don't want us to, you know, they're all in our business and da 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 da. But like, the longer you do what you're supposed to, you realize that that's not the truth. But at that moment, you're dealing with a lot of parents that are just angry, you know? So I think if some caseworkers just come in and say, you know, I don't want your kids. This is not what I'm here for, but this is my job, you know?
Alicia, I see you have, you want to add something to that, Alicia or Terry? All right, so the next question is an assembly. Hey, how can social workers motivate and encourage parents who are depressed? Who are depressed? That's interesting.
I've been waiting for that question.
Okay.
My mama should have named me depressed. I don't know why she didn't.
No, I like Alicia.
Look, let me tell y'all something. Even today, in October 28th, I have 2 years clean. But even today, I suffer from depression, always have. I felt when I was taken from my, I didn't have a dad, but when I was taken from my mom, she's paranoid schizophrenic, she's a junkie, drug head. That's where I came from. So as a young age, I felt lonely and abandoned and like not good enough. So throughout school, I didn't fit in with these people because I didn't have family. So I'm acting out and I'm doing, and I don't fit in and I'm not good enough. And I never felt comfortable with myself. I never felt good enough for anything. I didn't feel like I deserved to be a parent to my son. I didn't feel like there was anything better out there for me. Seeing all these people, everybody had trust funds and college educations and parents and drove Porsches. And I'm a single mom, you know, and I just never felt good enough. And I still am learning on loving myself. And so I love myself. I can't come out of depression, you guys. And that's why people act out and physically injure their children, not because of hate, because of the way they feel on the inside. That's why people like myself do, have always done drugs, because I don't want to feel like I feel anymore. And the only thing that takes away the pain and the feeling inside of my heart is drugs and alcohol. I was screaming inside and nobody could hear me. It was just me. And I will throw pity parties so lame, God will not even come to them. It'll just be me in this little circle. That's me. So I had to learn to care about myself, and my CPS worker did that for me. She said that I am important, and I am somebody, and I can do different, and she made me feel like I was worth something, and I love her for that, and still today, somebody has to remind me all the time, like, that I'm all right, that I'm worth something, and I'm starting to believe it, but I still slip up into depression. But before anybody can help anybody with their depression, a person would have to understand depression and the cause of depression, where it comes from, where it's stimulated from. There is a solution to every problem. I believe that today. But Albert Einstein said that you can't solve a problem with the same knowledge that created it. So we have to learn different knowledge to be able to solve those problems.
Well said. All right. The next one. What help would you like to receive while your children was involved with CPS? What kind of assistance could we have offered you?
I think personally, with the experience with my kids, kind of let them know also what's going on, because all of a sudden someone came and, you know, the kids aren't here no more. They're not allowed to go home and they don't understand why, you know. And as a parent, I personally didn't want somebody else telling my kid, your mom's on drugs, you know, your mom is depressed and just, you know, a mess. I didn't want somebody else to tell my kid that. I wanted to do that myself. So I think as CPS being involved, just kind of let them know, you know, mommy's sick, you know, and she's going to get better, you know, and we're going to help her get better so that way you could go back home, you know, because throughout this whole thing, my kids would be like, what's going on, mom? Like, why can't we see you when we want to see you? Or why are you in that place? You know, because I was in a rehab and they didn't understand. They would go and see me in there and they'd be like, what's this? And I kind of just told them, you know what, it's school. It's helping me be better. You know, it's helping me be a better mom. And I feel CPS could kind of, you know, come up with something like a support also, like for the kids, you know, how we have this parent collaboration group. I think if we could get, you know, children, have a support group for the children, I think that would be pretty good as well.
Somebody taking notes out there? Okay.
One of the things that I would have to say to that, one of the difficult things for me that I had to witness with, you know, with my two daughters was, first off, one of the biggest things that I've learned through this whole process of substance abuse is that it's a family disease. It's just not, you know, yes, I'm the addict, but it's a family disease and dysfunction. So obviously me going to treatment was what helped me and my wife. Now, through that whole process, I went through, you know, different processes where I first was allowed to have contact with my children. Then, you know, obviously I'm an addict. I didn't know how to quit. So therefore, okay, now you can't see them anymore without a UA. Couldn't pass a UA, so now you can't see them at all. And mom and dad are upset with me, so now you can't even talk to them on the phone because they're mad at you. And having said all that, it was just, I felt like me and my wife went to treatment, and yet my two young girls are set and do not understand what's going on. All they know is you won't let me talk to my parents. They don't understand what this is all about. And I'm just not sure. I don't know what completely the answer is. But if it's a family disease, then I think the family needs to be treated.
Wow, I think it's pretty powerful. And I'm hoping that folks here hear what you're saying there. All right. Did you ever feel like everyone was against you? If so, how did you cope, and what did you do?
In that situation,
you picked up. Hey, hold on. You still pick that microphone up quick? Yes.
I told you I wasn't going to be quiet once I got up here. I was nervous, but I'm okay now. Kind of what I did in that situation. Everybody thought I was bad. Nobody wanted to talk to me. You know, as far as family, the only people that wanted to talk to me were my friends, and that was because they wanted to help me cope with stuff by getting high or getting drunk. So in that kind of case, what I did is I went and found a different support group. When I went into these rehabilitation places, I met counselors. I met different people, like through NA or AA, because we would have support groups go inside of the rehabilitation home. So I kind of got myself, you know, to where I got phone numbers, and I started picking up, you know, I guess starting to talk to people inside of these things so I could have a different support group, you know. And this is where my life is going. It's not where I was. So these people know me now, you know, not my past. So it kind of helped me, you know, to make that image that I want for myself and be the person that I want to be today, instead of continuing talking to the people who were like, you're never going to be anything, because what they were doing was just basically shutting me down and keeping me there. You know, in my head works crazy. So like, I kind of had to, you know, find a whole different support group, you know, because apparently my family just didn't think I was going to change. So as far as them being against me, I just kind of said, you know what, they're not going to change. I can't make them see me who I am now. To this day, they still believe, you know, I wasn't coming to Houston. They're like, you don't have to go. Where are you going? You know, they still don't think I'm going to try and be better. They still don't think I'm going to, you know, be this person that I want to be, because I'm going to school for social work as well, you know. So like, I feel they don't believe that, you know. They believe that I'm still going to drop out like I did before. So the support group that I have now and the different friends that I made then are like the ones like, yeah, you could do it, Melissa, let's do it. And I keep them so close to me because that's what I need, you know. And regardless if it's family, love them from far, you know. That's what I have to say to that. Just love them from afar, and I keep them at a distance because they're not going to discourage me, and they're not going to bring me down at all. So.
I wanted to speak on behalf of CPS about feeling against me. Because when my kids were taken for the second time, and I was in that hopeless state of mind, where I really wasn't doing nothing but sitting at home alone, depressed, until, you know, I had to do something different. and I went to treatment, and I still didn't see my kids. My mother-in-law had my daughter, and she wanted to call a lawyer, and all these things were happening so fast, and I was in treatment. And I would call my two boys, and I'd talk to their dad, and I'd say, I want to see my kids. And he would say, no, you don't deserve to see them. You need to sit there and think, like, you know, like he's my dad. You need to sit there and think about what you did. And so I was depressed. Every time that nobody was looking, I was crying, whether it be in the shower. I mean, I was just this hopeless person. I just didn't know what happened, and I just wanted my kids. And until my family team meeting, I remained hopeless. I was in there, and I was crying and crying until my caseworker said, I just wanted my daughter there. It had been already 3 months, and I ain't seen none of my kids, you know? And she said, they can't keep them from you. You're still their mom. And right then, I mean, like, this hope came upon me because I didn't know. I just thought that they just took my kids and I needed treatment. And she told me, no, they have to let you see your kids. And that day, my daughter stayed with me. And that weekend, my boys were there to see me. And I told them, Mama's sick and she's getting better. But since then, and my case was transferred to the caseworker who now I work with, it was different. There was a light. There was, I mean, hope. There was so much more that she offered me. And I got offered into a drug court program where they have a support system whenever I mean, they helped with childcare and other mothers that I can reach out to because I'm a brand new mom, you know? So once CPS, the people that I thought was against me, let me know that they weren't, is when I got that hope.
In my situation, I did feel like everybody was against me. My family had, you know, my family were done. CPS was putting the hammer down on me. And this question's real easy for me. And now, knowing what I know now and working with parents and through this whole process, it amazes me sometimes because, you know, we obviously identified that I'm an addict. And you just taken everything that was valuable to me, and rightfully so. So mine and my wife's reaction was, we didn't want to feel that pain. We didn't want to feel this, you know, this kind of these emotions and feelings. So in our case, what we did is we used more. And then through that process, we got looked at, and the reactions that we got was, how dare they? I mean, and if we identify that a parent has a substance abuse issue, and we go in and we do these things, and my wife and I ended up homeless on the street. And we just, people look at us when we fail a UA, or they just looked at us like, you know, kind of a shocked and appalled that we would fail a UA, or, you know, it's like, okay, well, and that, as I look back, looking at that, you know, I often wonder, like, okay, you say I have a problem and I need help, so why is it so surprising that I haven't stopped? And so automatically, sometimes I think that people get it in their mind that, well, they obviously don't care. And that's not the case. It's not a fact that I don't care. It's just that I don't know how to stop. And I don't want to feel the pain. So that's it.
Thank you. Go ahead. Go ahead, Ashley.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to add to that. Because if we don't know better, how could we possibly do any better? And, I mean, I recently have a person that's been calling me because she wanted to stop. She wanted to stop. She went and got help, and she left wherever she left, so they called CPS on her. And the caseworker came and so on and so forth, and she's calling me, and she's like, I just want to get high. That's all I want to do. And I said, well, of course that's what you want to do. You don't know no other way. I mean, and nobody's, the caseworker hasn't gotten back with her as far as getting her into treatment, and I understand that could be a process, you know. And so, I mean, if you don't know no better, you can't possibly do any better, especially for, I'm speaking on an addict term.
And I just wanted to add to that, because like in my case, oftentimes what happens is we, you know, like, especially in the area, in the region for where I'm from, it's really common for a case to, like, okay, the caseworker's like, you need to go to substance abuse treatment. Okay, we go through the process of getting the screening, and it usually takes 2 to 3 months just to get into bed and get into a treatment facility. And so therefore, you know, you have that 2 to 3 months of that time period that, what is a parent going to do? I mean, what are you expecting from them? And so I think that understanding that component, and then the caseworker, oftentimes I hear in our meetings where, you know, they're mad at me because I ain't in treatment. Well, it's not their fault, you know. And so I think that we need to be understanding and understanding about that concept that it's a process.
All right, so look here, we are about 10 minutes away from ending this, so we'll open the floor up also for questions for you, if you have a question for the panel, after I ask this question, right? And the question that I'm going to ask you, what do you think about this thing called the Parent Collaboration Group?
I think it's like an awesome thing because I personally learn from experience, you know what I mean? So if I could have someone actually that's been through the process and actually experienced what I've experienced and I could hear them, it kind of gives me that hope, you know? And that's what I'm trying to do myself, is trying to put that hope in someone, you know, let them know. You know, I guess my family didn't grow up as far as addiction, but as far as like mental illnesses, my mom suffered from depression. So I grew up with my mom being very neglectful emotionally, you know what I mean? So I feel like if I could relate to somebody that's been in the same situation, I could help them, you know, because like how I said earlier, I'm here today. You know, and it's because of what I learned through the whole way. You know, if I can help someone out like that, it'd be best for, you know, it's a rewarding feeling. And it also kind of balances me out. When I go and speak to someone, it reminds me of where I used to be, you know, so it helps me.
Cool.
I think it is just awesome because I do have a really long history of being involved with CPS. To be on the other end of it is just amazing to me. I know that I have to give back to society what I took from society, and it makes me feel important and a part of something to be a part of this group. But there's so many people that don't even have CPS cases anymore that have been coming to the CPS group, to the PCG, to help other people, that it just amazes me because it makes us feel so good inside and to be able to support other people. And also, the problem we have found is the lack of support system out there for people like myself. And I'll tell you something, if you don't know where I'm at, you can't try to help me. You haven't felt what I'm feeling. You haven't seen what I've seen. I don't even hear anything you tell me. But these women, I've been in their situation. They are, and it's, you know, and we relate well to each other. And so I think that Deshaun and everybody else involved is just amazing for starting this whole group. It's so helpful.
Good. Anyone else?
Oh, I love it.
That's it.
Love it. Love helping parents. I like when I get the ones that are real, you know, ranting. You don't understand. I'm like, oh, yes, I do. I am you, you know? And then it opens this door. And I'm like, tell them about my kids. Not once, but twice. Like, you know? And then they want to, it's good communication.
I've been doing the parent collaboration group for a little over 2 years now. And it's just an awesome, awesome thing. We've grown our group from like 6 and 7 in a meeting to we're up to like 40 and 50 a meeting, and the reaction that I'm getting is we can get all the degrees and certificates all we want to, but I'm telling you that in my opinion, experience is the best teacher. And when I can sit down with a parent and empathize with them and tell them my story, it gives them something that I don't think that anyone can.
Anyone in the audience? Hold on, we're gonna get time to clap and standing ovation and all those kind of things, right? But anyone out in the audience have any questions for the panel that you want to ask a question? I can probably take a microphone and come out there, all right? Because I can come up with a few more questions, you know. We have one. Let's.
I think the answer would be the same from all four of us. We had a bottom. We had a pain that was sufficient enough to do something different. We had a bottom. And that bottom for most of us was without not having our kids. It was for me. When I was homeless and I was jumping houses and I was trying to find my next high, just dirty. I mean, that wasn't a bottom for me. The pain of losing my kid was my bottom. And working with addicts and people like myself, the pain has to be sufficient enough to change.
I just want to say, because, you know, I lost them twice, so really losing them the first time wasn't sufficient. Like, I didn't have enough pain because I got them back. And when I got my kids back from foster care, I got them back a drunk.
because alcohol was socially acceptable. And at the time, CPS really wasn't schooled on, you know, the drinking thing, because I was 21 and that's what we do, you know. And so when CPS told me that this was my last chance and that if I ever used or drank again, that I would never see my kids, and being that my mom is LCDC, and she knew she wouldn't get my kids, so nobody in my family would have my kids, and my kids would be in foster care. Like, I couldn't imagine. Like, my oldest son was already 10, and the look on his face when the police took him out of my home was sufficient. Like, my kids need me. I'm supposed to be a mom. So I kind of needed a threat, I'm just saying.
How she said rock bottom, but everybody's rock bottom is different. So I think mine was just when I kind of came to a conclusion that I didn't want to live anymore. You know, that was mine. When I felt not even my kids, you know, were worthy of me being alive just because of how miserable I felt, that was it for me. And I think that's when I just looked for the help, and it was just more emotional help that I needed more than anything, because, you know, I didn't have to do the drinking, I didn't have to do the smoking, you know, but I chose to just because of how ugly I was feeling, you know. And I feel like when I hit that rock bottom and didn't want to live no more, that was it for me. I needed help. So I did anything possible. Didn't say CPS was the perfect choice then, but now I believe it was.
All right, the final question is, what have you learned about yourself going through this process?
I believe that I'm strong now. I used to think I was the weakest person. I believed everybody when they told me I was no good. I believed, you know, that I was supposed to care for everyone else and not myself, you know? I believe that was where I'm now caring for myself. I could do so much, you know, because I'm no longer just helping people get on their feet, you know, how I used to. I'm actually trying to get myself together, you know, and caring for myself. And this is something I tell everyone. I hate that it sounds ugly, that it might come off as selfish, but I do come first now. And I think that's what I love most, because I am a strong woman and I could do so much. I just limited myself. And that's why I was telling Terry at the hotel we stayed at. It was amazing. I'm going to read it to you because this is something that I just really liked. And I took a picture of it. And sorry, give me a second. This is an affirmation that was actually on the elevator door. And I thought it was really neat. Sorry, I took a bunch of pictures of the hotel. Okay, this is where it says, there are no impossible dreams, just our limited perception of what is possible. And
read
to me,
one more time.
There are no impossible dreams, just our limited perception of what is possible. And that spoke so much to me because my perception was just right here. I believed nothing was possible back then, and now anything's possible.
Awesome.
Probably for me, through this whole process, one of the things that I've, the biggest thing that is important to me is that I grew through this, you know, most of my adult life in addiction, and I've been clean for almost, you know, 4 years now. And for a long, long time, I thought that's just who I was going to be, and that's just the way things were. And once I got to the point and recovery became possible, it instilled in me that regardless of my past, it doesn't have to define who I am, and that I can be a contributor to this world, that I can allow my experiences not only to help myself but to help others. And I think that's pretty powerful, that when through that process and then when I began to have that attitude, my perceptions on things changed. How I looked at the world and how I thought the world looked at me began to change, and things became clearer and much more, you know, optimism in this world, and being able to be a productive member of society just because I had, you know, I learned, one of the other things that I've learned is that I used to think that just people just automatically looked at me as a drug addict, and that's just, you know, I was the bottom of the barrel. And now I've learned that through the program of recovery that I actually get more respect from coming out of that barrel like that. And I never realized that I would gain that kind of respect coming through that. I just thought people just automatically judged me. I think it's been a beautiful process, and I'm really, really proud of it.
Thank you. What I've learned is that what I've been through doesn't make me who I am today. Who I was doesn't make the rest of my life. Decisions I've made does not set my future. I set my future today. I have the same 24 hours that everybody else has. I can sleep through it, get high through it, drink through it, or learn from it, and that's what I'm doing.
What have I learned? I have learned so much. Yeah. Like what everybody says, nothing is impossible today. Like, I'm a woman of worth. I walk with dignity. I dress better. I'm a mother. I pray with my children. I'm able to do things. I'm able to find things that I like to do as hobbies. I love giving back. I love that I got introduced to a program because I lost my children, because this program taught me so much about me and spirituality and things that I just didn't know. Like, I was okay with dying a drug addict, and now today that is just not an option. I am worth it today, and I know that.
Thank you so much. If you all could just stay just a minute. I wanted to tell you a story now. I didn't want to tell you this before the panel, okay? That we've had parent panels for many, many years. Something I learned about myself is that parents and families are the experts, and you all are. But we really struggled, and it's tough. You all are the most brave, courageous people in this room by far, and I want you to know that, because it's not easy under these lights in a big auditorium to tell your story. And we kept with this and kept with this, and with wonderful moderators and people that work with you, that you're able to come and tell your story so we can be better at our jobs. And so I really sincerely want to thank you all very much.